Hi everyone, welcome back to my video tutorials of computer organization and architecture. And from this video onwards we can start second module, and these are the contents of first part of second module. Okay, we can start with some fundamental concepts of instruction execution. An instruction execution consists of three different phases, like fetch an instruction, decoding, then execution. Fetch means with the content of the memory location pointed to by the program counter, and the content of this location are loaded into the instruction register. So in order to fetch the instruction, first identify the address value which is now available in program counter register. So move to that location and fetch the instruction available in that location and loaded that instruction into instruction register. Assuming that the memory is byte addressable and each instruction comprises 4 bytes. So increment the content of the program counter by 4 in order to pointing to the next instruction. So after fetching one instruction and placing that instruction into instruction register, and after completing the execution of that particular instruction, we want to fetch the next instruction, so that after fetching the first instruction we want to automatically increment the program counter in order to point into the next instruction. Okay, so here we considered memory is byte addressable and each instruction is 4 bytes in length, so that in order to get the address of next instruction from the memory, we want to increment the current value of program counter by 4. So that is why this notation, program counter is incremented by 4. The current value of program counter is incremented by 4 and store the new value to the program counter, so that after completing the instruction execution, that instruction is now available in instruction register. So after completing that particular instruction, we get the new instruction from an address location, that address value now available in this program counter. Okay, so instruction is fetched and available in instruction register. And decode the instruction and identify which operation to perform and on which operands. Okay, after fetching the instruction, then perform the decoding of instruction. Decoding means identify what are the operands and opcodes represented inside the instruction. So sometimes the operands again represent certain memory value. In such situation, we want to move to the location and fetch the value from that location and store it into some processor register in order to start the execution of the instruction. Then if all the operands are available, suppose all the operands are available, then carry out the actions specified by the instruction in the instruction register. This is actually the execution phase. So for executing an instruction, we have three different phases. First, instruction fetch, then instruction decode, then start the execution. Okay. This is a processor organization, which shows the interconnection between various units present inside as well as with external memory. So this indicates an internal processor bus structure. This unit is used for interconnecting processor with its associated registers. Okay, and we have either memory unit which is completely external to this processing unit. So we are here we have some certain register, memory address register and memory data register. These two register act as an interface in order to interconnect this processing unit with the external memory unit, or for connecting internal bus structure with the external memory bus. Here we have the program counter. Program counter holds the address values of various instruction, so which is connected with the internal bus structure. Here also we have the instruction register, and instruction register holds the instruction which is loaded from the memory location, and this shows certain general purpose registers like R0, R1, R2, etc., Rn-1. All these general purpose registers are connected with the internal bus structure. And here we have the decoder and control logic. Decoder logic is used for decoding the instruction available in this instruction register and then identify which are the operations to perform and what are the operands needed for the execution of the instruction. And this control logic help for generating control signals in order to control certain operations like memory access operations. Okay. Now this is our processing unit. This processing unit have two input and one output. Before that, here we have three other registers. Y register, set register, and a temporary location. Okay, temporary value. And these three register units are transparent to programmer. That means these Y, set, and term is purely dependent on the processor activities, and these are used by the processing unit in order to support its processing activities. That means this Y register holds certain value which is available from this internal bus, and this hold value here which is collected from this internal bus unit, and sometimes these values are taken as an input to ALU unit. And this set registers, and this after completing certain operations by this ALU, the resultant value before placing into the internal bus structure, the resultant value is temporarily loaded into set register. Similarly, this also used for supporting the activities of ALU operation. So all these Y, set, and temp are transparent to programmers, and these are purely dependent on the activities of ALU operations. So here we have a multiplexer. Multiplexer means two input multiplexer. Okay, and this multiplexer select a single actually this ALU operate using two input. One input is represented as A point and the other is represented as B. So this B input is taken directly from the internal processor bus, but the A input is taken by or chosen by the multiplexer, two input multiplexer. The multiplexer sometimes take this A value as a constant 4. Some other times the multiplexer select the value from the Y register as the A input of ALU. Okay, and this ALU can perform different arithmetic and logical operations, and after executing the operation generate result, and result is placed into set register temporarily before placing into the internal processor bus. And the multiplexer takes this constant 4 value when in order to increment the program counter value to pointing to the next instruction. In such situation, multiplexer choose this constant value 4 as a A input. For some other time, suppose our arithmetic logic unit want to perform certain addition operation or some subtraction operation, in such situation this multiplexer takes this A input as the value of Y register in order to perform addition, subtraction, etc. This constant value 4 is usually taken as an A input in order to increment the program counter value. Okay, so next is about this memory address register and memory data register. Already said that these two are used as act as an interface between this internal bus structure and the external memory bus. Suppose our processing unit want to read an instruction or some data from the memory, what we want to do, place the address location. Suppose we want to fetch a data, then place that address location into memory address register, then generate a memory a read control signal and generate the read command to the external memory bus, so that the exact location is identified in memory and fetch the value, then load that value into memory data register. Later, that memory data register content is loaded into internal processor bus, and we can store the value which is available now in this internal processor bus to some general purpose register or to some instruction register. Okay, and suppose our processor want to store certain value to a memory location, what we want to do, place the address, just like the previous case, place the address into memory address register, then generate a control signal, that is the write control signal now, then it generate a write command onto the external memory bus, so that identify the exact memory location from the memory, and also the data that we want to write onto the memory, place the data to memory data register, so that after identifying the exact memory location, fetch the value from this memory data register and write this value onto the exact memory location. So notice that this memory address register, the input is always given for this memory address register by this internal processing unit, internal processor bus. That is, memory address register is always loaded by internal processor bus. And this output of this memory address register is always connected with external memory bus. But in case of memory data register, during memory read operation, data is loaded to this memory data register by the external memory bus, and this loaded data is placed into internal processor bus. In such situation, the input of this memory data register is connected to external memory bus, and the output of this memory data register is connected to internal processor bus. And in the other case, suppose the processor want to write something to memory location, in such situation, this memory data register is loaded by a value from internal bus, internal processor bus first, then later that value fetched from this memory data register and loaded to some memory location, so that the input of this memory data register is connected to internal processor bus and the output of this MDR is connected to external memory bus. So MDR has two input and two output, but in case of MAR, it is always loaded with, or its input is always connected with internal processor bus and its output is always attached with external memory bus. Okay. Next is about instruction execution. Here we have some operations. An instruction can be executed by performing one or more of the following operation in some specific sequence. Okay, what are the operations? During instruction execution, data transferred from one register to another or to arithmetic logic unit, and transfer between ALUs takes place in case of arithmetic or logic operations, and perform an arithmetic or logic operation and store the result in a processor register. Next, fetch contents of a given memory location and load them into processor register, and store a word of data from a processor register into a given memory location. So data transfer between register and between arithmetic logic unit, this is one operation. Next, perform arithmetic or logic operation and store the result in a certain processor register, this is another one operation. Then fetch content of the given memory location and load them into processor register. Similarly, store data from a processor register into given memory. So, in order to complete the execution of an instruction, perform one or more of the following, one or more of these operations in a specified sequence. Okay, the registers, the ALU and the interconnecting bus are collectively referred to as the data bus. Registers, ALU and the interconnection bus, together known as the data bus. All these present in all these units present in this diagram, together known as the data path. And next is about register transfers. Consider this one. Here this is a particular register RI, and this is the internal processor bus, and this is the same ALU unit with a multiplexer and Y input constant 4, similarly as set register for storing the result of ALU operation. Okay, and this is a register RI. We want to know how to transfer data from an to this register RI. So consider a particular switch, that is RIN, which is connected to internal bus, processor bus, and is taken as an input to RI. And here we have another switch RI out, and act as an output of this RI, and is connected to internal processor bus. Okay. Whenever this RI in switch is on, what will happen? Transfer the content of this internal processor bus to register I. That means load the content of this processor bus to RI whenever this RI in switch is on. Okay, and suppose this RI out switch is on now, what will happen? Then the current value which is present in this RI is loaded to internal processor bus. This is actually the register transfer operation with the help of two switches RI in and RI out. Okay, suppose we want to transfer content of register R1 to register R4, and for transferring data from register R1 to register R4, what are the steps we want to perform? Enable the output of register R1 by setting R1 out to 1. That means place the content of R1 on the processor bus. So enable the output of register R1. How it possible? Enable the output of register R1. That means set this RI out to 1. Then this circuit or this connection become active, so that we can take the value from here and place it into internal processor bus. So enable the output of register R1 by setting R1 out to 1. Next, enable the input of register R4 by setting R4 into 1. This loads the data from the processor bus into register R4. While setting R1 out to 1, what will happen? This support for transferring content of register R1 to processor bus. Then setting the input of R4, that is R4 in is set to 1, what will happen? This R4 in R4 register is loaded with the current content of processor bus. All operations and data transfer within a processor takes place within a time period which is known as processor clock. In order to transfer data between registers and with ALU, all such data transfer takes place in certain time period, and this time period is known as processor clock. Suppose R1 out and R4 in are set to 1, and the registers are of edge triggered flip-flop. Register consists of edge triggered flip-flops. Hence, at the next active edge of the clock, the flip-flop that constitute or R4 will load with data present at its input, and the control signals R1 out and R4 in will return to 0. We have two registers R1 and R4. R1 out and R4 in are set to 1 now. So what is the meaning? We want to transfer content of R1 to register R4. And also consider these two registers are edge triggered. Consist of edge triggered flip flops. What is the meaning of this edge trigger? Consider this one diagram. This indicate positive edge triggering and this indicate negative edge triggering. In case of positive edge trigger, the data transfer takes place during this rising edge of clock. Similarly, in case of negative edge trigger, the data transfer between registers or data transfer with the ALU takes place during this negative edge or during this falling edge. Okay. So here we consider two registers R1 and R4, both are edge triggered. That means data transfer takes place during the edge of rising edge or during the falling edge of clock cycle. Hence the next active edge triggered means the transfer takes place during the active edge of the clock. The flip-flop that constitute R4 will load with the data present at its input. Its input now contains the value which is present in the R1 register, which is already placed in the processor bus, because R1 out is now set to 1. And the control signals R1 out and R4 in will return to 0. What is the meaning? After completing the data transfer between R1 and R4, the R1 out and R4 1 is automatically cleared. Okay. So this one diagram, this shows the implementation of a 1-bit register RI. This indicates the implementation of a register with the help of a D flip-flop. Okay, and also used a 2-input multiplexer as the D input. A 2-input multiplexer is used to select the data applied to the input of an edge-triggered D flip-flop. Edge-triggered D flip-flop means data transfer takes place during the active edge of clock cycle. When a control input R in is equal to 1, here the selection pin of this multiplexer is R in switch, and this tri-state acts as the RI out. Okay, when the control input RI in is equal to 1, suppose this RI in is set, the multiplexer selects the data on the bus. That means select data, whenever this RI in equal to 1, then select this multiplexer, select data from the bus and pass that value as the input to D flip-flop. This data will be loaded into the flip-flop at the rising edge of the clock. Okay, this particular register acts as a positive edge triggered flip-flop. So this data transfer takes place during the positive edge of the clock. When RI in equal to 0, the multiplexer feeds back the value currently stored in the flip-flop. That is, whenever this RI in value equal to 0, then whatever value now available in this D flip-flop, which will feed back to the flip-flop again. And whenever this RI in value become 1, in such situation the multiplexer select a new value from the bus and is passed to the D flip-flop as input. And whenever this RIN value becomes 0 and the multiplexer feeds back the value which is currently stored in the D flip-flop. The Q output of the flip-flop is connected to the bus via a tri-state gate. Okay, the output, Q output of this flip-flop is connected to the bus using a tri-state gate. When this RI out equal to 0, Then this circuit acts as an open circuit, and open circuit means the electrically disconnected state. Okay, so no data is passed to the bus in such situation. That is, whenever this RI out equal to 0, this circuit acts as an open circuit or a disconnected circuit, so that no data value, Q output, no Q value is passed to the bus. Whenever this RI out equal to 1, the gate drives the bus to 0 or 1 depending on the value of Q. Whenever this RI out equal to 1, then the circuit act as a closed circuit. Then this circuit act as a connected circuit and pass whatever value available now in Q to the bus circuit. Okay, this particular diagram shows the implementation of a 1-bit register. That means this indicates how to transfer a single bit of information to and from a register. And here this register acts as a edge triggered, positive edge triggered D flip flop. And here we have a 2 input multiplexer, and this selection pin is the RN input, and this tri-state has act as the RI output. Okay, whenever this RI in equal to 1, in such situation the multiplexer select a bit of information from the bus and set as the T input. And whenever this RI in value equal to 0, in such situation whatever value now available in Q, which will feed back to this D flip flop. Okay, this is the significance of different values of this RI in input. And similarly with this RI out, if RI out equal to 0, then this circuit acts as a disconnected circuit and no value will be placed into the bus structure. And whenever this RI out value becomes 1, RI out value become 1, what will happen? Place the current Q value to the bus structure. That means we can transfer this register content to the bus structure. RI in equal to 1, we can take value from the bus structure to the register, and this whenever this RI out equal to 1, we can take the value from register to the bus structure. Okay, thank you.